like a new buzzword, if you like, for community projects. So we do a lot of fundraising within the local community, and then the young people themselves decide on how to spend that money. And the type of things that we do, we tend to do backpacks in local supermarkets. We help the firefighters out with car washes on the fire station. We do sponsored silencers, anything that we can do to fundraise money. And then basically with that money, we don't have the decision as to what to do with it, the young people do. So we sit down as a group and we plan and we prepare. And it's just to get young people involved about how to spend that money. A recent one that we've done, the young people went to an old people's home and they played bingo with the residents. With the money that they raised, we took the young people to the shops to actually buy the gifts for the bingo. And then the young people went to the supermarket and bought the cakes for the residents as well. It only sounds a small thing, but that's a massive thing for young people to manage that money. They have to sit down and work out how to spend that money. They might never know how much a cake is. They don't know how much, you know, when we do the prizes, how much they are. So they work out themselves. So it's about budget management, you know, teaching them the skills quite early on. A lot of things that we do on the fire cadets, it's quite diverse, really, to be honest. It's not all about fire service activities. It's about giving them enrichment activities to make them a better citizen. So yes, we do fire safety. They all have fire kits. They learn how to work together as a team by doing lots of fun, exciting experiences with fire engines and hoses. But they also sit in a classroom. They learn things about water safety, fire safety, home safety. We have lots of guest speakers that come in. We deliver first aid. We're very well linked now with the police and various other community organisations who will come in and give the time to our fire cadets. And it's an opportunity for the young people to, as I say, to build up the CVs and to obtain a range of certification and qualifications as well. So currently, we have five cadet units. I have to think about that there. The first one, Croxteth Fire Cadet Unit, has actually existed for 9 years in the Fire and Rescue Service. It's run very, very independently, Croxteth, very successfully and very independently at Croxteth Fire Station. It was run by the districts, so it was sort of a little bit out on a limb, really. It wasn't sort of governed or managed to sort of run themselves, really. But now that we're coming into a national scheme, and my new job now is to coordinate all the fire cadets, I've sort of wrapped them into my coordination, if you like, because at the end of the day, all the fire cadet units, we want them to be the same. We want them to all run the same, so as people out in the community know what they're going to get when they come to our fire cadets. The other fire cadet units that are listed there are new fire cadet units that have only just been set up this year. So we've got Bootle and Netherton, Wallasey, St. Helens, and the one on the bottom is a little bit different. It's actually an after-schools fire cadet unit, whereas the other ones run it in the evening. The one, Archbishop Blanche, which is an all-girls school, actually runs at Kirkdale Fire Station. The reason why it's slightly different as opposed to it running with an evening programme for the young people is because all of our cadet units are all externally funded. They're all funded by an organisation called Youth United. Now, Youth United is an organisation that is made up of lots of uniformed services that work with young people. So the Brownies, the Scouts, St John's Ambulance, Sea Cadets, all the ones that we know about. But the fire cadets is still, it's still a bit of an anomaly. Not everybody out there knows about the fire cadets. So that's something for the national brand that the fire cadet board are going to introduce. That's what we're trying to get that brand out there so the community knows what the fire cadets is and the community knows that they can ring up the fire service and inquire about fire cadets. In addition to the cadet units that are up and running now, we also have a proposed fire cadet unit in St. Vincent's Visually Impaired School in Liverpool. And that's a school that we're working with at the moment with the aim of having a new fire cadet unit. If I'm being honest, we're probably good to go with St. Vincent's in about September this year, so that's what we're looking at to open up this new fire cadet unit, which will actually be delivered in the school as opposed to on the fire station. That's my short presentation. Any questions?
Right.
Thank you,
Julie, for having us. Sure. Just a couple of questions, please. I just noticed on your cadet units that there's one based in Knowsley. Yeah, every sure. District, Middle, Captain, Liverpool, and St. Helens are all very intensive. And the second one question I'd like to ask is obviously your training when you put the Knowsley issue up. You mentioned every school and every one of them was with an item. Can you give me a breakdown of like a breakdown from please, an item of what's going on in Kirby, Haywood, Prescott, if that's possible?
units. The reason why cadet units...
I don't mean just the cadet units, but from the
groups. Yeah. Our Princess Trust has always been delivered from Haiti. So they've always been delivered from Haiti. And the Head Start programme that we just delivered in the school fire is Moston Bridges, is in Haiti. And the fire the primary fire cadet was in a Haiti, was in a Merseyside school. Going forward, not sure what that happened. Knowsley have made a massive there's a big loss refunding for further funding. That's just been sent. So it's not the outcome of that when we continue our work in the areas, not the set of the primary fire cadets. But how we will still continue with the new 1R programme or return to a Princess Trust.
I understand that, but what I'm looking at in Knowsley, there's a place called Kirby.
Well, that's the one.
Mentioned within that zone, and also there's Prescott and Aylward within Knowsley as well. And what I'd like to ask is, where are they all fitting in? It's not just being heightened, there's other areas within Knowsley.
See, a lot of the Knowsley one, what we're in talking to now, Knowsley Community College, we are looking to run it from a Cllr Fire Station. That's where we're heading for. Unfortunately, some of the funding that comes through, because there's other delivery departments, is that we have to be careful of where we're putting Princess Trust, because it'll be it'll be too many PT programmes in certain areas. That then impacts on retention and figures. When the new station at Prescott, that's when we'll be delivering some youth engagement from the new Prescott Fire Station. And also, it is dependent on the funding that we receive from the colleges. Only allow so many teams to be delivered, and we try to do pan Merseyside as much as possible, because sometimes it is on around the figures around ASB and around where people are unemployed. So there's lots of factors why the five districts have been chosen, but we will always look to work with Knowsley. But as I say, we are in talks with Knowsley College to open a new Princess Trust from a Cllr Fire Station.
I understand that, but what I'm saying to you more than anything, if you look at the issue when you just carry them out, even with KHC, you just mentioned the funding of £25,000. This KHC covers Kirby, it covers Prescott, and it covers parts of Aylward. What I don't want everything to be seen is centralised and heightened. There's no exist of other areas within the Ledger, Bridle. You can't just focus on one area.
And
that's, as a Kirby councillor and representative of Nobody, that's what I'd like you. My views is that we need to spread that out.
Oh yeah, absolutely. We'll always attempt to do that, but
you've got to give all communities the opportunity.
Oh, yeah.
You can't just pick one little area and stick to that area. It's diverse, it's appreciating what problems you've got in Haydn, no different than what you've got in Cairn or Aylward or Prescott. And all I'm asking for is that I'd like to see a bit of transparency that is shared across the five areas where I've just mentioned.
Yeah, some of our hands are tied because it's the wish of the funder. It's not always it's not always MFRS to say,
yeah,
we would like to go these. They will say to us, this is the area we're willing to give you the funding for. And we, you know, and that's what we will take. But I take your point that we will always attempt to try and get to as many places as we can. But we do encourage, because when we did have some children from the Kirby area, because a local group paid for them to come in, so we used to bust them into our team. But we are in talks, as I say, with the committee.
I'll speak to you after the meeting, because I'd like to take that a little bit.
Yeah, that's fine.
Who the provider is from them, if that's the case.
Just make some broad comments. I think it reinforced probably coming from the camp side around. Sometimes we are beholden to the funder. I think members will appreciate that. All the programmes we're delivering are based on funding which is provided externally with Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority. So Princess Trust, as an example, Bromborough, in a nice and pop way, is not the ideal location to deliver our Princess Trust programmes from, because of where the station is located. But we are dictated to by the funder, because they have other provision around the Birkenhead area, and they don't want us to stray into that particular area and compromise the offer to young people. And when we looked at our initial, the fire cadets as an example, we are starting to grow the fire cadets model, not only locally but nationally. But if we focus on Merseyside, what we had in the past was one unit. That was the unit that Susie described in Croxteth, developed on the basis of some members of staff who wanted to kind of get involved, and we've supported them through those processes. Now Youth United have come and are supporting the development of the National Fire Cadet model across the whole of the UK. What they came back to, certainly myself as the chair of that group and, you know, representative of CFO, what they tried to do is direct us to specific locations based on higher levels of deprivation. And so they would talk about platinum areas, and they would talk about developing cadet units in platinum areas, which were focused on deprivation. And clearly, as a representative of Merseyside, that works reasonably well for us because of the high levels of deprivation. But everywhere else across the UK, it probably doesn't have the same kind of attraction. And so what we sought to extend their outlook was to include areas of social isolation. So all of a sudden, it made, you know, it more accessible to other fire and rescue services as well for some of the access to the funding. And they've continued to fund us on that basis. But, you know, Councillor Halpin's, you know, comments are absolutely correct. We've said all along, particularly to members as part of the development of our youth engagement offer, if you see gaps in our provision, so gaps in whether it be Kirby or whether it be anywhere else in Merseyside, and if you are able to support us in access and additional funding to support the delivery of some of those programmes at that location, that would be something which we would be, you know, very appreciative of, because I want to develop the fire cadet model. And we talked about initially, you know, my ask of the youth engagement team was to take it from one to take it to five, one in each one of the districts, and then potentially take it to 10, so two in each one of the districts. So you're not travelling more than, I don't know, maybe 5 or 6 miles to be able to kind of attend a cadet opportunity, or have a cadet opportunity available to you. That's similar in relation to the Youth United's kind of ethos about opportunities to volunteer and opportunities to be involved in youth activity, but they're less fire specific. They're more about, well, you know, they've got a scouting opportunity somewhere and so on and so forth. So this is about developing the brand and developing the card, the offer, and certainly if we are able to facilitate that through some of the card, the local authority connections, we will do that, absolutely. And, you know, I would love to have a cadet unit operating out of Heighton, one operating out of Prescott when Prescott's developed, and one operating out of Kirby. That is something which is, you know, clearly an aspiration to kind of work on that basis. And that extends across the whole of Merseyside, really. Why am I saying that? Because when you go back to the outcomes that we're seeking to achieve, you know, fire cadet isn't just about, you know, young kids coming to a fire station and squaring water. It's far more than that. And we are starting to have conversations with Cabinet Office and civil society around what it does. What it does, it builds character in the young person, build resilience in the young person, it allows them to come out with a qualification of some type or other, whether that be a Duke of Edinburgh award, whether that be a BTEC qualification, or whether it just be a certificate of attending for 12 months if there's some, you know, capacity issues within that particular young person. They've come out of that process with something that they can take to an employer. Right, and we want to put that on the same footing, really, as a fire cadet, you know, as being in the same as completion of the Duke of Edinburgh award, and that be transferable into employment opportunity. But what it also does, part of our activity, it builds on our capacity to deliver social action. So all of a sudden, when I'm talking nationally about a day of social action for fire cadets, I'm trying to, you know, try to expand it to covering the 11 uniform services, and certainly the, you know, police cadets and St John's ambulance cadets are part of the discussion. You know, I want to introduce a day of social action where you get cadets and young people out on the streets of Merseyside or beyond, just, you know, being visible in their communities. Why? Because, you know what, that adds value to what the, you know, to the community, cleans up areas and so on and so forth, but also as a visual representation of how positive young people can be in the delivery of their community. And so, you know, we are looking to grow, not shrink, and it's been quite a difficult challenge that. When we talk about Prince's Trust, you know, we have fought tooth and nail to protect Prince's Trust, and we've moved from one college to the other to be able to sustain it. When we're talking about fire cadets, the reason why I'm so keen to create a national model is so I can access national funding to support it and implement it wherever we feel it is appropriate. And I would love to be able to say, you know what, we're going to determine where we place these cadet units and these Prince's Trust programmes, but sometimes, you know, it's just not necessarily within our gift. But again, the same proposal goes to members, is if we see gaps in our provision, whether it be our youth provision or somebody else's youth provision, and we think that a cadet unit or a Prince's Trust team programme or something akin to that can meet the needs of an area, and there's a potential for that to be supported financially. And you know, and us work with that potential funder, then we would embrace that every single time. So I'd welcome the opportunity to have a chat with Cllr Halpin outside of this meeting to see whether there's ways in which we can look to put something into Kirby. I think it would be a really valuable asset to the young people and the community.
Can I just add as well, just finally, that it is envisaged that on this cadet unit, subject to funding, we're looking at the new fire station, Prescott fire station, because not all fire stations are suitable for young people, so that's why we're waiting for Prescott fire station and further funding to be developed. And also with the fire cadets, we've only got two staff that actually run all those programmes. The rest of the staff are made up of volunteers, so obviously to enable us to run more cadet units, we have to have volunteers in place. So currently we've recruited 20 internal volunteers, which is fantastic. And that is the aim of the cadets, that it will be run by volunteers. So obviously to develop the cadets, these units are going to start up in January. So as they grow arms and legs, we're hoping that we will develop more and more cadet units and obviously try and recruit more and more volunteers as well to enable us with that journey. Can I just leave a couple of guidance notes just about my cadets, just if you want any more further details?
Well, thanks, Karen. Thanks.
Thank you.
You accept the recommendation of failure at this place?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so, page 55, mm-hmm. Item 5, and E.
I'm waiting for Mr. Flanagan.
Ian's report is only a page and a half. I'm sure we will get through that relatively quickly. As members will know, part of the former planning process was to look at, you know, scrutiny opportunities, and members were directed officers towards a scrutiny of the mobilising process and the role of fire control in that process. So that's what Ian will take you through over the next number of minutes. And you were able to provide scrutiny as and when appropriate.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Ian Walsh. I'm a station manager within the operational compartment function, and I currently hold responsibility for managing the day-to-day operations in the fire control room. The aim of my presentation today is to provide a brief overview of the role of what fire control is for the fire authority, and an understanding of the mobilising process in its simplistic form. And to do that, a number of objectives, obviously there's legal requirements placed upon the fire authority. And then there's some national guidance that fire control operations fall under. Give you a brief overview of our current fire control setup and the establishment, and then just briefly look at the mobilising system we've currently got in place and the arrangements that we have in place for the mobilisation of operational response assets. So these lessons and requirements, the Fire Rescue Services Act, over a number of sections, 7, Fire, 8, RTCs, 9, other emergencies, asks us to make a provision, in particular, for dealing with calls, and more importantly, for them, someone help for members of the community who require our assistance. From a national guidance perspective, we have what we call the Code of Practice for Public Emergency Call Services, and that's between the communication providers, call handling agencies. So the communication providers will be BT, based in media, etc., call handling agencies, BT Liaison 999, and the emergency authorities, which Fire Rescue Service is one of them. In the past, the fire sector has had fire service manuals, operator manuals, and nationally through CFRAL, which is our government body in CFOA, we're looking to create a suite of national operational guidance documents, and fire control operations actually falls in the operations section. And what that does is that basically provides strategic guidance so that individual fire rescue services can take away, pass that to their policy writers to come up with a procedure, process, etc., etc., to undertake fire control operations. The Code of Practice allows, again, for consistency amongst the emergency authorities where we can take calls free of charge. Then calls where technology allows will present a location, whether that be postal address or whether it will be a geographical location. So from a mobile phone, using the technology available to try and pinpoint exactly where the location is, and offer, as I said, yeah, a consistent way of working for emergency call agencies, because members of the public that may be vulnerable, traumatic circumstances. It allows us to then to be able to manipulate that call to the advantage of that individual requesting an emergency response. So, Merseyside Fire Control Room. Our Merseyside Fire Control Room is based here at the JCC, where we have the primary control room. So under normal operations, that's where the emergency call handling process will be undertaken from. Should we have any impact upon our normal business, there is a backup facility at our training academy in Croxteth, and we can relocate staff and replicate the setup that we have here at the JCC. The fire control handles all the 99 emergency calls from Merseyside and is responsible for the mobilisation of all fire appliances, senior officers and other specialist assets that may be required to successfully resolve such emergencies. And they also hold the responsibility for maintaining the levels of fire cover. So what I mean by that is that if we have a fire in Southport and we mobilise local appliances, the fire control manager and mobilising officer will have the responsibility for backfilling to ensure that we maintain a spread of fire cover within the authorities area. So the establishment currently operates across a 4-watch system based on 12-hour shifts. So day shifts, 7 o'clock in the morning to 7 o'clock at night, and conversely the night shift is 9 to 7. It mirrors what we have at our whole time stations, however the time, the start timings are a little bit different. It's 08:30 for operational stations, and what we have then is we have a continuum. We're not changing all the shifts at one time. The establishment, again based across the 4-watch system, is with 32 whole time equivalent posts, and of that we have a number of managers and a number of operators. All the managers and operators are trained the same to be able to take a call and to dispatch resources. So we don't have a split of people who just take phone calls and people who actually mobilise resources. They're all on the competence and they can all adapt accordingly. We have a minimum staffing level of 6 on-duty personnel at any one time, and that will include 2 managers. One of the managers will be responsible for the fire cover, and they have titled the mobilising officer, so sorry for going so quickly, but a short period of time. So the mobilising officer is responsible for the holistic review, whereas the watch manager and the manager in charge manages the day-to-day operations of the group. So the system. So we currently operate mobilised vision FX system with an integrated comms and control system. What's that mean? Okay, what it means is we have an integrated telephony and radio system which operates off single touch screen apparatus in the control room. So operators can take calls as well as communicate with our responding resources. It also allows us to hold a large database of the addresses of Merseyside, which includes postcodes, unique premises reference numbers, site-specific information. I heard one of the members ask about oxygen, use home oxygen. That will be entered into the system as well. So we can carry a small amount of risk data, which is then available for all responding resources. Also within there, we have a multi-level mapping facility. And I'll, when I come on to the mobilising arrangements, you'll see where that assists us in having what we call effective and efficient mobilising of resources. It holds contacts directories, so we have our single point of contacts for our local authority partners, for other emergency responders, and other category 1 or category 2 responders which may be called upon to assist in the resolution of an emergency instance. When we take a call, using the system, we then deliver that to the station end equipment. So every fire station has equipment that we can send response information to them when we wish them to attend emergency calls. That will manifest itself as a tally system and a printer on the stations where we can deliver text information to the crews, and they take that and they go that. They can then turn out to the address where the emergency occurs. That's replicated because every appliance has a mobile data terminal on, which is basically a screen affixed into the front of the appliance cab. And the information that you get on the station end equipment replicate itself on a mobile data terminal. So if there's any problem with the printer, we've got resilience, we have backup. And also, if they're not on the station, we've got about undertaking community activities, or they're out training, or they're returning from an emergency event, we can mobilise them directly from the mobile data terminal. And in support of that, we have an Airwave radio. Airwave is a national framework for interoperability between all emergency services and other emergency responders. And Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service allocated a number of talk groups, and the appliances have the ability to pass voice messages to and from the control room using voice. So, in essence, if we can just move to the next slide, so what we have is, this is the network diagram for the Vision FX system and the SM1000. So we have the control room, primary, secondary, I've got to remember not to touch the screen, apologies because I don't want something turns over. We have the number of 999 lines that come in, so we have a primary set. If the primary set are all in use, it will then go to a secondary set of 999s, and should they be in use, because we've got widespread flooding, we've got particularly hot weather, and we've got a large number of open area fires, then we also have the alternate lines as well. So there's a number of lines that come in, they'll take the call, the call's processed, and then it's basically sent to either the station or the fire appliance for them resources to be mobilised to them particular emergency incidents. So how do we do that? Okay, I'll mobilise the radios. Number of broad headings or strap lines if you want. So our mobilised radios are, all our operators are professionally trained in taking emergency calls. So they're trained to ask a set of primary questions, and basically they are, where are you? What's your problem? And how can we help you? But then they can interrogate that if it may not be straightforward. So they'll use questioning techniques to abstract the relevant amount of information for us to be able to make a suitable response. To help them, we create a number of incident types. I mean, you've heard from the performance management figures that, you know, deliberate house fire, car fire, rescue from height, rescue from depth, water rescue incidents. So they'll create incident types. And what that does is that gives our mobile operators the ability to quickly assess the right amount of units or appliances that need to attend that type of incident. And it's all tied around the training for the right speed and weight of response to successfully deal with an incident. That then will fall into predetermined attendances. So what we'll have is, for a house fire where there's no person trapped inside, we will initially send two fire appliances. Should we be unable to confirm that the house is free of occupants or any people inside, if it's persons reported, that speed and weight of attack increases by an extra appliance. And that allows us to put in a safe system of work. So the mobilising arrangements will fall around the call handling questions, potential incident type for that particular incident, and then marry that up with a predetermined attendance. The action plans are there for those incidents that are a little bit more complex. An example would be cloudburst at a Comar site, where the action plan requires more than just a standard fire rescue service response, because there's an off-site potential and we engage with our multi-agency partners. So the action plans are there to assist the operators to contact the right agencies to provide, again, the right speed and weight of attack at that particular type of incident. I mentioned before about the multi-layered mapping within the mobilising system. All the appliances are fitted with automatic vehicle location systems, and that allows us to mobilise dynamically. So we take a call to an address, and historically that might have been in, for say, Birkenhead's area. But we know we've got an appliance returning from the training academy to Upton, and they're closer. The dynamic mobilising allows us to mobilise resources closest to that instance. Finally, mutual aid. With the finite number of resources that we have, should we see ourselves in what we call spate conditions, so there's a high level of activity, we've got appliances responding to a high number of activities, the control room will also be able to initiate mutual aid from our regional partners. And if the incident is complex, protracted, or potentially has national ramifications for, say, if I recall, the Didcot power station where they had the collapse structure there, or the Bosley Mill incident where you need more of a specialist type of response. Fire control can basically train in initiation mutual aid arrangements with our regional and national partners. This is the natural whistle stop tour through the fire control fire control setup and the mobilising arrangement to support operation response for Merseyside Financial Service. Are there any questions?
Yes.
Do you know when the ships change over?
Yes.
Like the night time. Is there a handover?
There is. Although they just aren't finished time, but what happens is the staff will come in and there will be a handover period between the two. So there's never any break in the availability of operators, if that's your question. Sorry.
Yeah.
It's very, very similar to what happens on fire stations.
Right.
So where the oncoming shift comes on, they'll come on just beforehand, mm-hmm. and then there'll be a seamless transition, so there's no impact upon performance.
Right. And the other thing is, then one call that you're dealing with now.
Yes.
What's the operator doing now? How is that?
The operators, again, what happens is that if we have any new or specific mobilising types, we'll engage with our other the functions within this, whether it be response, whether it be protection or prevention, whichever that might be, and we'll come up with a set of guidelines for that particular incident type, and we'll create a familiarisation training for the operators. We'll engage with the agency. So, for example, North West Ambulance Service came in, and we had them conversations with them to say, okay, you're going to pass this type of information. How do you want us to process that? How does that fit in with the way our operational response model is?
So,
you
used CAFs?
CAFs?
Yeah.
The appliances still carry CAFs, yeah.
Yeah.
You're talking about the foam, the compressed air foam? Yes, you do.
Yeah. It's not used that often, though, is it?
Again, the use of CAFs will be determined by the incident commander, depending upon the specifics of the incident.
All right, that's all I want to ask.
Any other questions? You know, when someone phones in, as, like this interview about a young child vulnerable or the mother not being well, how do you track the call? Have you got ways that you can find out?
If the call comes from a landline,
yeah.
Under the PECS agreement that we mentioned first of all, when I was talking about location finders, if you use what we call the ISEC details, or the call line indication details. So under the agreement that we put in place, is the likes of BT, Virgin Media, they allow that information to be displayed within the control room. So, and again, it will come, it's hard to explain, with the ICS, what happens is that if a call comes in on a landline or a mobile phone that's registered through one of the registered subscribers, so it's on pay as you go,
yeah,
it will display as either the individual's name or the phone number. Yeah. So if a small child rang from a landline, it may come up as Mrs. Thompson. And what we can do then is if we lose that call, we've got the ability, because through the recording system, to go back and ask the operator, where's this address? So the ISEC details allow us to, if we can't get that information from the caller, mm-hmm. is to have recourse back to the call handling agent to say, we've got the phone number, can you give us the location? Does that answer your question?
Is that the same for a mobile? Can you track where a mobile is?
A mobile, it's not specific, it's within a geographical area. There's a current piece of work ongoing at the moment through the BT liaison committee, looking at using the mobile to provide us with a more accurate location. So if you got a mobile call from a motorway saying someone didn't know where he was, we tried to get it down to around about 10 or 15 metres of the location of that mobile.
No, I think Ian's covered off most of the points.
Now we start forward there. Which should be page 57. Do any members have any comments on that?
If
you
just make some suggestions, please, on the comments that have been made by members over the period of the committee. Members will be aware that we deferred the kind of the details around the consultation process because we were going through an internal audit process. We may well have concluded that by the next meeting, so we may be able to bring that report back to members at that particular point for scrutiny. In addition to that, we will certainly bring back a report in relation to the implementation of our new HR policies and the impact that that's had on, you know, sickness absence, which will allow us to scrutinise the details there and, you know, the performance against those particular areas. And there is a report due around environmental performance, again, which I would suggest we bring back to the next meeting, Chair. In addition to, you know, you may want to consider the comments made by members that in relation to the emergency medical response, and we may be at a point for the next meeting to kind of consider the pilot of being implemented across Merseyside at three locations currently to see what the impact of our is on our response, but equally to see how we've managed some of the calls in regards to emergency medical response while we are dealing with the cardiac response aspect of the work that we've embarked on in part of the national pilot. If we are in a position to chair, it may well be that we bring that back part of the scrutiny arrangements for that plan to be taken further to the full authority. But as I say, if we are in a position to at that particular junction.
Any comments?
Okay. Just a very quick one. I mean, we did talk about some time ago now, and it must be well over 12 months ago, about inviting some of our partner agency representatives in, really. And I think it was at the time when there was a number of issues in relation to fires in care homes. And I'm just wondering perhaps if somebody, you know, could perhaps pull something together, a bit of a programme of perhaps who you think might be useful to have come in and we can talk to them. I mean, you know, I mentioned just as a for instance, I'm not saying that one, but about the home oxygen and how that works. And I mean, you can answer your question clearly, you know, from our point of view, but just to see how they see it fitting in with their organisations as well.
Absolutely, and we can take a look at the card, the areas that we've identified, and the consultation process may be an example of that, where we can either bring in someone from ORS to provide a little bit more scrutiny into their role within that consultation process, or indeed, if the internal auditors are content, maybe bringing Melanie Dexter, who can talk about their role in scrutinising or considering our consultation process within that internal audit mechanisms as well, so that would give members an opportunity to hear from someone other than someone employed by the service.